You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
First of all, we're going to look at a couple of the questions of the day and the Let's Take a Walk. Could we see the first one, please? Yes, I'm the instructor. How can archaeologists and historians justify the removal of objects from tombs and graves? They do that not necessarily for reasons of profit and pillaging, though that has been the case, but also they do it for reasons of preservation, because the climate's not good for various reasons. How does the clash of cultural values affect our perception of artifacts in the graves of other cultures? And that's a good follow-up to that question, because it asks us to consider whether, if we go, for instance, to LACMA down here in Los Angeles, and we see I don't even know if they have one, but for instance, a sarcophagus of an Egyptian pharaoh. Do we look at it as some magnificent work of sculpture, of art? It's gold covered, it's decorated. Or do we just look at it as, oh, gross, they've stolen a burial. They've stolen the tomb of a dead king of Egypt. So that's the first question. Is expropriating these things good or bad? And by the way, I don't know if you guys know this, but George Clooney's wife is actually an extremely famous, internationally known lawyer, Amal Amuddin. And one of the things that she was working on right when they got married was she was working on the repatriation, which means the return, of a bunch of the ancient Greek sculpture that ended up in Britain, in London specifically, and in the early 19th century, and having it sent back to Greece. All right, that's the first question. The second question is, and this is kind of tongue-in-cheek, and it's actually extremely obvious. What evidence suggests that medieval art was dominated by the Christian religion? Now, when I say evidence, it's visual evidence. And when I say visual evidence, I mean specifically themes. And so you just use your idea of themes. You use your idea that we talked about, context, the environment in which the art was made. And then finally, Let's Take a Walk is going to show something kind of cool. It's the Great Sphinx of Giza. I think you've probably seen it before. There's a webcam. I don't know if it's Google Earth, but there's a webcam where you can actually see it. You can see people walking around and taking pictures. So that's going to be the Let's Take a Walk for this week. And it's a cool image, and there it is. There it is. It's behind, in front of a pyramid. It's actually not that far from a big city, and it's just been there for many, many, many thousands of years. Perhaps the worse for wear, but still pretty darn impressive looking. Perhaps I think we might be able to say it is Egypt's equivalent to Mount Rushmore. Anyway, there you go. So the phone number is coming up. The email is coming up. Let's have a go with these. So test results. Good job, folks. The mean of it, I can't ask you directly because we're not live, but what's the difference between an average score and a mean score? An average score, obviously, you probably know, is everything's you add everything up and divide it by the number of people taking the test. The average score was actually an A-, which is pretty dang good. So congratulations, well done. A couple of you, for whatever reason, didn't take the exam. and I hope that you're okay. And if you're watching this, contact me. We can figure something out. But I just want to see if you're okay. My goodness, we already have responses to the question, to the Let's Take a Walk. Katrina writes about the Great Sphinx of Giza. Thank you for writing. The Great Sphinx of Giza is one of the most well-known statues in the world. When you look closely at its face, it looks human and even has human ears, but it has the body of a large cat. The hair looks like it's a lion's mane, or maybe even the head. Yeah, that's a good description. One of the reasons it might seem that we're cramming together the ancient world, the pre-ancient Greek and Roman world, the Greek and Roman world, and Christianity all together, is because there's a very interesting thing that happens in the course of art at the time. And very simply stated, Christianity, when it came along, it had one God. All these other religions that came before Christianity, there were many, many, many kinds of gods. Animals were worshipped. A bunch of different kinds of people were worshipped. The Greeks had their gods. They had Zeus, and they had Apollo, and they had Hera, and they had everybody. And so when you look at a lot of ancient art, the interesting thing is that there's a lot of religious subject. So there's a lot of different kind of art. And actually, when I look at this, I'm just going to take a brief aside. The thing that fascinates me the most, and I love ancient art, I love ancient Greek art, especially Roman art, and I've seen a ton of it, is I always wonder about what we don't see, what's been destroyed. I mean, it's been many thousands of years. A lot of this work, probably most of the work, doesn't exist anymore for various reasons. Warfare, climate, whatever. And I'm sure that there's always things that have been made, and perhaps I always speculate better, I don't know. But I think it's just fascinating to think about it. And they're still finding ancient Greek and Roman stuff, still. A fisherman a couple years ago found this amazing bronze statue, massive, at the bottom of the sea. It was a Roman statue, a Roman copy of a Greek statue. So anyway, okay. Brandon, question of the day number two. Thanks, Brandon. How do you know that the work is about, the theme is Christian, Brandon writes, because it portrays that Christianity is good and other religions are evil. That's a possible answer. I think, you know, we've heard a lot about, I mean, I've brought it up a couple of times, how the ISIS, for instance, and before them the Taliban, they are and have been destroying a lot of monumental, priceless, if you put a term to it, work of art that's existed from other religions. And I called it the ultimate form of art criticism. But it's also a fact that when Christianity was spreading like a fire through Europe, that Christian people were also destroying a lot of Greek and Roman stuff. So it just goes in waves. And, you know, it's because of themes. They're not looking at these things as works of art. They are looking at them as symbols of a religion which they don't believe in. And because they don't believe in it, they have to destroy it all. We have a long response from Philip. Thank you, Philip. He has pictures. When I visited my grandparents in France, there were old medieval churches and cathedrals everywhere that showed medieval art was dominated by the Christian religion. As mentioned in our textbook, most of them tried to draw your eyes upward to heaven by the pointed arches, columns, and towers. Not only that, excellent point, but not only that, if you go inside of these things, your eye just shoots up too. Because like Philip writes, the point of it was it's not about art, it's about religion. It's about getting people to focus on God, and heaven is up. Heaven is vertical. So everything was pointed to make things go up into the sky. I actually climbed on... Wait, what? You did? I actually climbed to the top of one of the towers of the Chartres Cathedral when I was 8 years old. Holy moly. The artwork outside and inside had sculptures of saints. Actually, we're going to be looking at those. And beautiful stained glass windows, and we're going to look at them too, as well. Showing the sacred realm theme. I was mostly interested in the gargoyles at that time, since I was only 8 years old. You can see part of a gargoyle in the picture I've attached after climbing to the top of the tower. I hope to see it again sometime now that I'm older and know more about looking at art. Philip, that's fascinating. How fortunate of you to be able to go and do that. I don't know if we're going to be able to show the photographs that he attached to it. If we can do that, that would be fantastic. Thank you, Philip. Okay, we're going to keep doing this for a sec. Emily writes for question number one. Thanks, Emily. Artifacts removed from graves and tombs help archaeologists learn more about the period in which the artifact existed. As long as the artifact is well preserved and taken care of after removal, many people will be able to enjoy viewing the artifact in photos or museums and grow in their appreciation of that historical era. That's a very good point, because she's saying that if you think of it as art, art is universal. Art belongs everywhere. It's like I say, it's the universal language. And in that respect, yeah, you want to make art available to everybody. But if you look, you can look at it from another angle too. I'm not saying that her response isn't correct, but it's perfectly valid. But there's two ways to look at this. The other way to look at it is not as art, but as something religious and something sacred and something iconic. And if you look at it that way, it means something entirely different than it would to somebody who's looking at it looking at it just as a work of art. But there's many different responses to that. And you guys indeed have hit the ground running. And I'll get to some of these, but we got to move on just a little bit. When I'd sent out the Google form to see if you guys would, and to my other two classes as well, if you're all interested in going to the Museum of Latin American Art, very high interest. There was like 90% interested and like 10% maybe. So interest is there. Now, what I'm going to try to do is I'm going to send out because the trick is going to be getting this available on a Sunday. And I know a bunch of you live way down south, way up north, and I'll account for that as well. I'm going to send out something called a doodle. A doodle is a form, and I'm going to propose two or three Sundays. Sundays are the day when the museum is free, and at 11 o'clock, and it would take about an hour. Like I said, I'm going to try and get the curator. I just learned the director's resigned. He just resigned. So the curator I'll try to get. If not, I can introduce you to the museum, and then we're going to have an extra credit project. Those of you that obviously live very far away or otherwise can't make it, I'll have another extra credit project available as well. So you also have an opportunity to earn some extra credit points. So up until now, this is the beginning really of literally the second part of the term. The first part of the term was an introduction to art. We began it with just general thoughts. Art is everywhere. Art has an audience. Art represents some kind of beauty. Art has an appearance. Art has a context. It's everywhere. I didn't try to define art. That's for you guys to figure out. So we had general thoughts. Then we spent 3 weeks talking about the acquisition of what I call a vocabulary, a visual vocabulary to talk about art. The first way was the themes. There were seven or eight of them, and there's a gajillion more actually. A theme is simply the story that the work of art is telling you. This allows you to compare and contrast work from different eras, different centuries, different millennia. You can talk about political art. You can, it's a great way to tie together a bunch of different kind of art. Second thing we did was get some insight into visual elements. So you can literally take art apart, irrespective of content, irrespective of theme, and talk about it in terms of its color, its shape, its space, its light, all that stuff. And then finally, we put everything into kind of motion. Elements are static things. You isolate aspects of art. When you talk about the design principles, you are talking about things combined. So you have rhythm. Rhythm can be shown in the way that lines move, in the repetition of shapes. You can look at it in terms of, you can look at art in terms of subordination and emphasis. You know, if it's a king, the king is going to be like five times bigger than his subjects. So that's a vocabulary to talk about art, about the content and about the the material of it, the different elements of it. And quite frankly, I do have an emphasis for the course. I mean, this is all significant stuff, but that is really the most important thing to me. And I hope you've at least given some thought to it, because irrespective of the kind of art that you like, irrespective of where you live and the kind of art to which you are exposed, you can take those three things, themes, elements, and design principles, look at stuff, evaluate stuff, compare it, contrast, and when I say evaluate, you can say, I like it or I don't like it, but instead of finishing your analysis just saying that, you can say, I like it because, I don't like it because. So now what we did, we talked about the processes and materials, and we went through all of, you know, painting, different kinds of painting, the different kinds of drawing, two kinds of drawing, wet drawing, dry drawing, the seven or eight kinds of painting, sculpture, very labor-intensive sculpture, especially lost wax process, architecture, I believe there's 11 or 13 structural systems. So you now have a sense of how art functions, how it looks, why it looks the way it looks. You had a very brief introduction to context, in other words, the situation in which art was made, the parameters in which it was made, and why it was made. What we're going to do for the rest of the term, we are going to look at art in its historical context. No more terms. We're just going to look at a ton of images. And we're going to begin today. We're going to go through the Middle Ages. We're going to do the Renaissance next week. And all the while, like I say, a ton of images. This is going to be about looking at stuff and just understanding generally the sequence that things happened in, keeping in mind that art doesn't exist in a vacuum. It was made, as we saw before, art has an audience. It was made because a king commissioned it. It was made because a wealthy person commissioned it. It was made because a pope commissioned it. And later on, we're going to see that in about the middle of the 19th century, we're going to see that art was made just because an artist wanted to make it. And that's going to be a big part of the way that we're going to think about and conceive of the identity of an artist. They're going to go from being craftsmen and craftswomen to being full-fledged independent workers in the art economy. Anyway, okay, we're going to look at a couple more of these. Kristen writes, thank you, Kristen. I believe that archaeologists have the right to remove artifacts because it allows us to enjoy them. If we simply leave them hidden and undiscovered, they have no value to us. The context of these artifacts have a high impact on the viewers. Bringing them to the public in museums allows the greater public to enjoy and appreciate them. Yeah, that's absolutely true. And you might be interested to know, if you didn't know already, the idea of a museum is very, very recent compared to how long art's been being made. The idea of a museum, we can trace it back perhaps to the French Revolution when the king was overthrown and his work was put into a museum, the Louvre. and then people could see it. Before that, you couldn't see art. The only way you could see art was to go to church. And even then, you didn't look at it as art. You looked at it as a way to pray. And because at the time, a lot of people were not able to write, they were able to understand the gospel in stained glass windows and sculptures and things like that. Anyway, good point. Good point. Thank you. Okay, let's move forward a tiny bit. All right, last week, we talked, or 2 weeks ago, we concluded with architecture, and I just want to do a quick little dinky review. Among other things, we looked at suspension bridges, and suspension bridges are nothing more than pylons, which I will show you in a moment, of the good old Golden Gate Bridge, right there. Oh, and I am not seeing it. I saw it. All right, anyway, there it is. All right, so basic idea. Pylons, the bridge, the cables. So you got the cables and the cables, and it supports it. It gives a lot of play. The platform that the cars and bike riders and runners like me used to cross daily, there's a lot of room for seismic activity, and because of the wind, is it 8 or 15 feet? But you can actually be moving a lot. And the second one we looked at was at a viaduct in France. And again, just the basic same idea. We had the pylons. We had the viaduct in France coming up. I know it's coming up, I think. Maybe not. All right, anyway. So what we're going to do now is we're going to talk about the ancient and Mediterranean worlds. Can we please see the slide of the topics we're going to cover, please? We seem to have technical difficulties. Okay. Oh, there we go. Thank you. So, what we're going to cover today, and this is like a third of what we're going to cover. So, ancient Mediterranean worlds. We're going to talk about Stone Age art, like Stonehenge kind of stuff. Mesopotamia, Sumerian, Assyrian, and Babylonian. Now, the interesting thing when you talk about Mesopotamia, it's actually quite famous in the news today. It's part of it includes Iraq. Okay, that's where all this stuff is going on in Iraq. We're going to talk about Egypt, where we saw the pyramids and Sphinx, the Aegean, which has went through three different eras, the Cycladic, the Minoan, and the Mycenaean. And then we're going to talk about the classical world of Greek and Rome. I just want to mention art historically. We talk about the Aegean, we talk about the Cycladic, the Minoan, and the Mycenaean. And then in art history, in our textbook, they say that each of the Cycladic and the other two, they're known because they have portraits of women, because they show pictures of animals. But the fact of the matter is, there's not a lot of stuff that's left of that. So when they say that that's what it is, that's not the only thing that it is, but that's what exists right now. And that's one of the things when you look at art history, ancient art history, because it's not documented, and it's not for lack of interest. It's because writing didn't necessarily exist. If it did, it was fragile. It was done on stones. Those things vanished. Nothing's digitized. There's no Instagram, things are not documented as much as they were, but anyway. So we're going to look at those three. We're going to look at three videos today, they're all made by the Khan Academy, and we're going to look at them for the rest of the term, actually, and for each art historical period that we do. And I'm always looking for videos to show you guys that give a good introduction to the historical period that we're going to do. And of course, they've got to be brief. I can't go showing you a 20 minute video. They've got to be interesting. Now, I can find videos. In fact, one of my old professors at Berkeley is one of the world authorities on Greek art, ancient Greek art. And he is on YouTube all over the place. I do guarantee you, if I played a video of, I'm not going to mention his name, talking, you go to sleep, because he knows everything about it. but it's not the most engaging thing. He's a scholar. Anyway, so we're gonna watch a video in just a second, but we're getting some interesting responses here to these questions. So first we're gonna go through a couple more. Katrina writes again. This is question number two. Some proof of Christianity in medieval art are halos around figures in paintings and mosaics. Yeah. There are also themes of death and resurrection with winged angels coming down to take a person to heaven. Another theme I see is the Virgin Mary with her son. Yeah, so that's correct, Katrina, thanks. She's looking at it in terms of the halos, which is a sign that it's around the head, that the person is a holy person, and she's looking at it in terms of the themes. Really good. Okay, one more, then we're going to look at the video. Sage, thank you, Sage. Sage, I think, has a different take on this. Yes, for the first question. It's always distasting sometimes when historians and archaeologists removed objects from tombs or graves, but it's still understandable. If they did leave the objects there, another group of people could come by and destroy or take the objects for themselves. So I think it's fine for them to take objects for museums so other people can see, or to take them so people can find more meaning behind them. And I really don't understand the second question for this. Thank you for the first part. Can we look at the slide again? I gotta see what the first question of the day, please. I wanna see what that second part is again. No, the first question, please. Okay, how does the clash of visual? So I'll just use the example I used before. Let's say that you weren't even alive then. In 1979, the Metropolitan Museum in New York had a blockbuster show of King Tut. Blockbuster. Tut mania swept the world. There were costume parties with King Tut. Themed clothes and music and everything. Saturday Night Live had a very funny skit of Steve Martin, the comedian, doing the King Tut dance. So he's dancing. He looks like one of those figures on the wall. And it was insanely popular. It was the first blockbuster show that the Met had ever done, and therefore one of the first blockbuster shows in the world made to make a big splash. It was very, very interesting. It came to San Francisco, and I saw it. I tried to see it. There were too many people in the galleries. So that was well and fine. But even back then, I had to wonder what the big hoop-de-doo was, because, yeah, it was insanely beautiful. We're going to look at some slides of King Tut, not of him, but of his sarcophagus. Everything's gold, everything's beautiful. But the fact of the matter is there's a mummy inside that. It's a dead body. And yeah, many, many, many thousands of years ago, who knows who his relatives are. But the fact is the culture clash. We're looking at it as art, but you could very easily look at it as kind of, as you say, distasteful for uprooting something like that. That's a very popular example of that. And there's many other ones too. For instance, all around America, there's Native American burial grounds. And there's always problems with when people try to develop on the property and things. And so there's a culture clash, and it comes down to themes, because one person's art is another person's sacred realm. I hope that explains your question. Okay, let's get moving here. Let's look at a video. It's 6 minutes and 15 seconds. It's an introduction of the ancient world that goes up to Greek and Roman art. We're not going to get there yet. We'll look at this, and then we'll look at some examples of the work. Thank you.
Art Cyril Patoy here, but you can call me Art. This is Explorations in Art History, starring me! And the hand. Well, what about the rest of me? How embarrassing, people watching from around the world, and I'm stuck waiting on some five-fingered prima donna. Oh, well, that's better. It looks like we'll be talking about the Mesopotamian and Egyptian period. We're going back 5,000 years to a place the Greeks called Mesopotamia, which means land between the rivers. Those rivers were the Tigris and the Euphrates, which formed a fertile crescent, sometimes called the cradle of civilization. Oh, very funny. Mesopotamia actually refers to an area rather than a country. At different times, it was ruled by the Sumerians, the Akkadians, the Babylonians, the Assyrians, and the Persians. They lived close to the natural world, and like this lion that decorated the walls of the Ishtar Gate, their animal art was pretty realistic. Their human art? Not so realistic. Both Mesopotamian and Egyptian artists stylized the human body. In Mesopotamia, they invented the first written language called cuneiform. They started with pictographs, but over time, the writing evolved into more abstract symbols. They also got to invent cool names for their buildings like ziggurat. In Ur, they built a massive ziggurat to pay homage to the gods. Ziggurat. I love the sound of that. The ziggurat was the center of the city. Moving on. Mesopotamia may have started the civilization craze, but Egypt took it to a new standard. Egypt depended on one great river, the Nile, and developed a civilization that lasted over 3,000 years. When Tutankhamun became pharaoh, the Great Pyramids were already 1,000 years old, and it was another 1,000 years after that when Cleopatra held power. Egyptologists invented an ingenious system to classify the different periods of Egyptian rule. There's the Old Kingdom, Middle Kingdom, the New Kingdom, and the Later Kingdom. How did they think of that? Interestingly, artistic styles never changed much over 3,000 years. The best artist was probably the one who could most closely copy the classic style of the past. What was good enough for Khufu was good enough for Ramses. Except for one brief moment called the Amarna period, when a pharaoh named Akhenaten ushered in a new style and a new religion. All of a sudden, faces got stretched, bodies got streamlined and lengthened, thin was in. But when Akhenaten passed away, Egypt quickly reverted back to the old familiar ways. That doesn't mean Egyptians weren't creative. Just look at their pantheon of gods. They imagined jackal-headed gods and hawk-headed gods, lion-headed goddesses, rawr, hippo-headed goddesses, oh my, crocodile-headed gods, and ibis-headed gods, cat-headed gods, and, well, you get the picture. Of course, the pharaohs themselves were considered the living gods. Pharaohs were portrayed according to specific rules that emphasized their perfect, unchanging nature. Usually, these representations included some symbols of authority, like the royal headdress, the crook, and the flail, and a false beard. Even the female pharaoh, Hatshepsut, commissioned statues of herself with the false beard to reinforce her position of authority. Oh, attractive. Egyptians obsessed over death and the afterlife. Paintings on the walls of tombs often showed the Ba, or soul, on its journey through the afterlife. When an Egyptian artist painted a figure, every body part was shown from its most recognizable angle. The face was shown in profile, except for the eye, which was shown head-on. The body was shown head-on, and the legs and feet were twisted back into profile. Don't try this at home. Alexander the Great admired the Egyptian kingdom so much that he decided to conquer it in 332 BC. While in Egypt, he founded the city of Alexandria on the northern coast of Egypt and installed his general Ptolemy as pharaoh. Greek elements were introduced into the arts. The Ptolemaic dynasty lasted 275 years and included several Ptolemies and Cleopatras. The most famous of these was Cleopatra VII, whose son, Ptolemy XV, was the last pharaoh of Egypt. In 30 BC, Rome conquered Egypt.
That is a brief overview of the ancient Mediterranean worlds. And what is significant about this, and this is an art class, so we can't talk about the history, the politics, the society, the law, all that stuff. But if you have taken, are taking, or will be taking classes in Western civilization, classes on law, on democracy, classes on warfare or history of warfare, all that, it all begins right there in the Mediterranean. It comes out of this and it gradually moves forward to an apex when you come to classical Greek art. So we're going to look at it very briefly today, unfortunately. All of this, today we're starting to look at stuff about 5,000 years ago. What's happened in the meantime, especially early on, there were many, many, many civilizations, and they were coming and they were leaving. They were spread out all over the place. They weren't connected because there was no transportation. It happened very quickly. And of course, there's not a heck of a lot of documents or works of art or anything that exist. So the little that we do have is of a special interest. We're going to talk about Paleo, the Paleolithic era, as he said. It's the Old Stone Age. And the Old Stone Age is it's hunter-gatherer lifestyle. It's Stone Age because all they had were stone, rocks for their tools. Later on, Neolithic, they called it the New Stone Age because what happened, instead of hunting and gathering and never staying in one place long, people actually settled down, agriculture was developed, and once that happened, then there was relative permanence to societies, and that's where the art that we're going to look at very briefly cropped up from. We have a lot of the art, but we don't have a clue what it means. We're going to look very briefly at a cave painting, very famous cave painting, and it's of animals. A lot of this work tends to be of animals, but from this era, don't know what it means. Is it a diary entry? Is somebody just saying, oh, I saw a bison or a buffalo today? Is it some kind of a wish fulfillment thing? Like, oh, I wish we could find a buffalo so we could hunt it and use the skins for shelter and for clothing. We don't know. There's a lot of speculation. But the fact is, the general consensus is that the earliest kind of art had magical properties. And we're going to look at an image of a fertility figure. And what it does, it's of a woman, and we're just going to say that she has exaggerated reproductive figures. And the reason these were made, we speculate, is because somebody wanted his wife to have a lot of kids to help survive in wherever they were living. So we're going to begin with the ancient Mediterranean worlds. We're going to look at the oldest art. We're going to look at a cave painting in Lascaux. It's incredibly old, but the interesting thing about it, it looks very modern. It looks like Picasso could have done it. I mean, and the interesting thing is, it was found by accident. These kids, they found it in Europe. And I believe it was 1940, they found this cave, and they went deeper and deeper, and they found a cave full of all these animals, paintings of all these animals. Don't know what they mean, but these are among the earliest made objects, probably magical of some kind. And then we have the Venus of Willendorf, which is one of those, it's called female figure. That's one of those fertility figures. So. I think we can safely say that's not meant to be a decoration. It actually had a function. And the function was perhaps by creating it or having somebody create it for a family or a village or a cave dwellers, that it's going to help ensure that the wife has a lot of children. So now we go, because we're flying through time right now, we're going to look at Mesopotamia. And Mesopotamia, as I mentioned, is very interesting because it's literally the cradle. It's called the breadbasket of civilization. a lot of amazing, interesting, and very influential things happen there. And right now, it's exactly in the middle of where the war is happening in the Middle East. We're going to look at the Sumerians. They were the first people recorded to have left artifacts, things like the fertility figure and written words. It was cuneiform, and we're going to look at that. I think you might have seen it without really knowing what it was. It was the first kind of writing. It was made by taking a sharp object and writing the words into damp clay, and then the clay would dry. Of course, it was fragile as anything, and obviously it couldn't be reproduced. We're going to talk about the Assyrians. The Assyrians, they're known for they're called citadels, which are like forts or fortresses, and they're known for their palaces. Another famous theme was lion hunting. Again, we're saying this only because that's what exists. We don't know what other things we did. And then finally, we're going to look at the Babylonians. And the Babylonians, it would be extraordinary to have been alive then, because they made amazing architecture. And we're going to look at Babylon. And there was a king named Nebuchadnezzar, and he built Babylon, and it doesn't exist. But we're going to look at a contemporary reproduction of the entry wall, or entry gate into there. So first we're going to look at, for Mesopotamia, we're going to look at a ziggurat, which is just a massive fortress in the middle of nowhere, easily defended, okay? We're going to look at an image of a ram in the thicket. So it's an animal figure. Okay. We're going to look at the head of a ruler. Right there. Okay. We're going to look at a human-headed winged lion. And then finally, we're going to look at, two things. We're going to look at a lion hunt from a palace complex. And then finally, and you'll notice the king, that's the king, and the king is much, much bigger than everybody else. He looks like he's almost as big as the horse. So that is emphasis and subordination right there. And then finally, we're going to look at a restored gate. It's called the Ishtar Gate from Babylonia. That is a sense of what it would have looked like to enter Babylonia through the main gate. It's just extraordinary. So now we come to Egypt, and as animated as that little video clip we saw, it was actually pretty good and pretty informative. The most famous architecture from Egypt clearly is the pyramid. It was very hierarchical, as the video showed. Men were larger, women were smaller in scale. Men were typically darker colored, women were typically lighter colored. The most important thing in Egypt was gold. Gold meant wealth, but it also meant the life-giving rays of the sun. And any time that you would portray a god, including a pharaoh, because he was the earthly embodiment of a god, their flesh was represented by gold. So we're going to look at just a quick fly. We're going to fly through Egypt. The burial mask of King Tut of Tutankhamun, the boy king. So I bet that's gold, by the way. King Tut's tomb was discovered by an English archaeologist, I believe in 1924, Howard Carter. And if you don't know the story, and you're interested not just in archaeology and art history, but just in like a detective story, there's some really interesting books. And you could just read the Wikipedia article too about the discovery of the tomb. They didn't know it was there. He kept digging around. He had a eureka moment. He came into this thing. They didn't have electric lights, by the way. They had whatever, candles of some kind, or torches or something. All of a sudden, there's a burial chamber, and it's filled with gold, with King Tut, with jewelry, with very fancy ornaments and objects. And this comes back to what Sage was talking about, because you can be totally blown away by the opulence of this and just be totally impressed by it. But at the same time, for heaven's sakes, theoretically, even if it is a king, it's also a sacred site. It's a death site. So you can look at it from a bunch of different ways. Okay, we're going to look at very briefly the Cycladic, the Minoan, and the Mycenaean cultures, brief-lived. The Cycladic was very famous for its women. Again, we know that because that's what has been found. So we have a statue of a woman in the Cycladic culture, and don't know the purpose of it. It looks pretty angular, and it looks very 20th century too. And we'll talk about that briefly, but a lot of artists in the 20th century started looking back to ancient art to get ideas. So there's that. The Minoan culture was very famous for their frescoes that they had in their palaces. We talked about frescoes a couple weeks ago. Fresco, wet wall, wet paint, you paint it, it dries, it's embodied in that. And this is, of course, it's an animal scene, meaning whatever it was supposed to have meant. And then finally, we get to the Mycenaean culture, and what they're most famous for is their use of gold and their elaborate, very elaborate burial practices. And again, we only know this because of the things that archaeologists have found. So this is a riton in the shape of a lion's head. Okay, now, so that's what leads up to ancient Greece and ancient Rome in the ancient Mediterranean world. And again, what you have to realize is these things weren't happening overnight. We're talking about hundreds, if not thousands of years. They're passing ever so slowly. But everything is constantly changing. And nothing is necessarily linked, because there's no transportation. There's no freeways. There's no trains. There's no written documents. There's no newspapers. So everything is built up in isolation. Every once in a while, there's going to be a war. Things come. Things go. It's very temporary. But then you come to the ancient Greece, and later to ancient Rome. And the Greeks are especially well known for their philosophy. And because they're well known for their philosophy, it only stands to reckon that they would be the very first people to speculate on exactly what is art and what is the use of art. And you can see it throughout the various things that have remained. And you'll notice as we go through this term, this crash course in art history, as time progresses, we know more and more and more about the art. So the stuff we just looked at, we don't know a heck of a lot about, because there's no primary source material, much less secondary source material, that would tell us what was the purpose, what is this, what is that. As we get into the Greek era, a lot of it still exists. It's kind of battered and beaten up and stolen, taken to other countries, but we have a pretty good record because we also have a lot of the writing. So a lot of the painting that we know about Greek, a lot of the painting that came from ancient Greek art was done on these massive things that they used to carry wine in and olive oil in, and they're called craters. A crater is a wine vessel. Can we see an image of one of those, please? A crater from the Diplon Cemetery. And there you go. And so what they did, they would paint on it and then scratch, and the image of whatever it was, and we don't know exactly what the figures represent, but a lot of the art that comes out of ancient Greece is functional art. It was made by craftspeople because we didn't, the idea of art was still not like we know it. It wasn't something made to embellish a house. The idea of an aesthetic experience from art was absolutely unheard of, but things are starting to change. Art is becoming more intellectual. So when we talk about art, we're talking about there's three phases of art, and the phases of art are the archaic, and that is 6th century BC. And the kind of work that came out of that, and we'll look at that in just, we can look at it right now. They have a choros, which is an image of a boy, or a young boy. So it kind of looks Egyptian, but you'll notice one foot's in front of the other. It looks very lifelike, and the expression is still kind of, it looks kind of Egyptian, but it's, you're starting to get movement into these things. And so a choros is a Greek boy. We don't have an image of it, but a chore is a Greek woman, a young girl, a teenage girl. The classical era is from 480 BC to 323 BC. It was the high point of Greek art. Athens was the center of Greece, the artistic center and the political center. That's where all the relics and the monuments, when you talk about ancient Greece, you're going to see the Parthenon. Well, there it is. You see a bunch of statues, and as we saw with the choros, the images are starting to get movement into them, and they're starting to get a contrapposto pose, which became very popular in the Renaissance. And I know it seems kind of strange that these things had to actually evolve, but they did. You had the Egyptians standing straight, very rectilinear. You could only see them from the side, except for the eyes. Now they're starting to get motion introduced into these gradually. So we've seen the image of a crater and of a choros. Now we're going to look at an amphora, which is another vessel, and it's called Endocrates and the Endocrates Painter. And again, it's very flat, as you can see. Everything is going sideways, but unlike Greek art, you've actually got warriors with their spears and their shields, and they've got momentum, and they're moving towards each other. We have an image of, it's called Warrior A, and the interesting thing about Warrior A is he was found pretty recently. I believe it was a fisherman that found him, and they hauled him up and they put him into a museum. So who knows the story? Was he on some kind of a ship or something and the ship sank? Who knows? But again, that leads me back to what I was saying at the beginning. I'm very curious, and I'm constantly speculating this. What else don't we know about these cultures? And you know, a very, very brief aside. There's a bunch of plays and a bunch of poetry and a bunch of histories and a bunch of Greek comedies and everything. A lot of them don't exist anymore. Apparently Sophocles wrote a bunch of plays that we no longer have. Aeschylus wrote a bunch of plays which we no longer have. It's fascinating stuff to think about. We have an Itkinus and Callicrates from the Parthenon. Same kind of idea here coming up. And again, oops, wrong thing. You see the post and the lintel structure of architecture, okay? Support right there. These things were highly decorated. That's the entablature. That's a whole different kind of sculpture. It was not sculpture. And you can get a scale of how big this is by looking at these people in comparison to that. We have an image called the Three Goddesses from the east pediment of the Parthenon. The pediment is one of those top things I just showed you. Again, these are large, and they're missing heads and arms and stuff. But the amazing thing about it, look what's happened in the comparison of, as time is passing, you see the choros, for example, it's not a very dynamic image. Now look at this. Look at the way the dress or the robe or whatever it is just moving like it's water or like the wind is blowing over it. It's very, very interesting. We also have probably the most famous Greek statue ever. It's called Aphrodite of Milos, but more commonly it's known as the Venus de Milo. And there's a lot of jokes about she doesn't have any arms. And then finally, we have a very dynamic image called the Laocoon group. And what it is, actually, is this is a Greek original sculpture, but the Romans made a copy of it because the original no longer exists. And so a lot of Greek art is preserved through Roman copies because it was destroyed. Now we talk about Rome. Now, the Rome, when you talk, again, we've been doing this the whole term and we're going to continue to do this. When I talk about, for instance, the beginning of modern art, you know, middle of 19th century, something like that, museums, maybe the end of the 18th century, the dates are not necessarily precise because you can't pinpoint the exact beginning of ancient Roman culture. But for sake of argument, it's the textbook, I believe, says it begins in 510 BC. So that's good enough. A lot of it, what has to be acknowledged is the fact that it overlaps with the Greek era. And that piece we just saw means a lot of Greek art was still around. And then it either got destroyed, it got stolen, it just wore out. What we're going to see in just a couple of examples, as we look at Roman art, it is much, much more realistic than ancient Greek art. And the word that we would actually use in this term would be, it's representational. Greek art was more abstract, it was more stylized, it removed all traces of individuality from the person, and just made it like a generic boy, a generic girl. When we start getting into some of the Roman work, we're going to see, for instance, that one of the popular art forms was portrait busts of ordinary citizens, presumably rich ordinary citizens. So these are actually people that did exist. There's a lot of frescoes that came out of ancient Rome, and some of the most important ones came from Pompeii. And I don't know if you've heard, I bet you've seen the frescoes without necessarily knowing where they came from or their circumstances. Pompeii actually vanished off the face of the earth one day in 79 AD. Mount Vesuvius exploded. Nobody had a chance. A few things were saved. The frescoes were saved. I can't remember why, but it's quite a testimony that's how the city would be remembered. The Romans, while they've got a ton of sculpture, they're best known for their architecture and their engineering. And the most famous work of architecture for the Romans is the Colosseum. So first we're going to look at a double portrait of Gratilda M.L. Crati and M. Gratidius Labanus. And it's a husband and a wife, and it's made, presumably, if we saw them in person, we would say, oh, I know those guys, they're my neighbors. In other words, ordinary people are starting to get portraits made of them, portrait busts made of them. We have a wall painting from the Villa of the Mysteries from Pompeii. This is one of the things that was in Pompeii. The other day, somebody, I believe it was in Sweden, they digitally reconstructed the Villa of Mysteries, and they created a 1 minute 45 second video of the Villa of Mysteries to show what it would look like, because they had plans of it. They found plans of it, and they kind of knew the kind of work that would be in it. I didn't show it because I think we've got a bunch of other stuff we need to look at here. This is one of my favorite works of art of all time. I've remembered it when I saw it when I was a student. It's a floor mosaic. Remember, a mosaic it's a floor mosaic depicting sea creatures. Okay, the next one, please. And it's, as we saw in materials, it was painting, I think. A mosaic is stones, colored stones put together. So this is sea creatures, and it's from Pompeii. And it's something that would be on the floor of a dwelling. The fact that that's made out of stones is absolutely astonishing to me. The Romans, as I mentioned before, were known for their architecture. And in particular, they were known for their Colosseum. And we have an image of that coming up. Yes, it's in ruins right there. But you get a sense of scale. There's people right there, and there's how big this is. They had spectacles. They had, well, they're not bullfights. They're other kinds of spectacles. And they were very popular. They were very violent. But the architecture, I have to think that our modern conception of soccer pitches and football stadiums is based on the idea of a Colosseum from ancient Rome. What else do we have? And then we have a mummy case. Okay, this is from Egypt, but it's actually Rome. It was found in Egypt. It's actually Roman. And you can see, so it's like the King Tut. So there's, you know, the head and the feet are down here. But the fact is, we don't really know what King Tut looks like looking at his burial mask. We would have a very good idea who this person was. We don't know if he died at that age, or that's the age the family wanted to remember him by, and he was older when he died. But that's the way that he looked. I think we should take a break now. We're going to take a 5-minute break. We'll be right back. Thank you.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, my name is Obi Wogboy, and I'm currently a junior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. The reason I came to this school was for the great environment, the small class sizes, and the amazing sociology program.
Mm-hmm. Many of our brothers feel like they're a part of a family, whether it's the culture, color of the skin, or just being comfortable with other men. The bond keeps growing, and the brotherhood keeps strengthening itself through those means. The Male Success Alliance at Cal State Dominguez Hills is creating a genuine brotherhood.
It does not force you to be anything. It does not require you to be a certain type of student.
We're here emotionally, physically, and anytime a brother needs anything, we're going to be there.
A lot of times, men of color aren't seen as professional, or you don't even see them in professional settings. So the Male Success Alliance is trying to get our men ready within their undergrad to be in that professional setting because they are the professional. The manner that the program is doing this is through the concentration of being there for our brothers. The practical way of doing that is, you know, redefining and strengthening the brotherhood, you know, within the campus and through the workshops and different events that we have. The suit is that signal that we're trying to create. You know, that whole changing the narrative is coming through the suit. When a man's able to be clean, they feel good. It gives this confidence and it oozes out of the guys.
Watching Dr. Franklin and Matt Smith, you know, walk around in these nice suits, it's like, hey, I want to be like that. I want to be him one day. I want to be able to wear that nice suit.
And you see it, the results are better academics, more social, a better social life, and a lot of guys just want to be a part of the program because of it.
The Male Success Alliance found me in a very interesting time place, trying to balance classes and my home life. I started to really fail in many ways. I found MSA on my verge of not being a student anymore. Meeting the actual student body president of the Male Success Alliance, I met him and it was like, nah, brother, you are my brother, and anything you need from me, just let me know.
And that's what MSA is built on. How does each one teach one, and how do we bring our brothers along with us? And that's why MSA sets that legacy in terms of, it's not just about CSU Dominguez Hills, it's this region, it's this state, and it's the nation, and these young men are going to change all of them.
My name is Alex Guerrero, and I'm a Toro.
My name is James Harris, and I'm a Toro.
I'm Jordan Sylvester, and I'm a Toro.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello and welcome back. We are going to conclude our romp through ancient Greece and Rome with another video, 7-minute video. Before we do though, I want to read Bella's response to the second question of the day, what indication is medieval art Christian art? And the reason I want to read it is because, and Bella, by the way, wrote a poem for one of the responses a couple of weeks ago, which I still can't get over. The reason I want to read this very briefly is because now we're going through art history and we're looking, as I said, at work in context. And so here's what she says, and I'll tell you how to think about it in terms of the rest of the term as well. Bella writes, and thank you, Bella. When one thinks of European medieval art, it's pretty obvious that it is Christian dominated. The church was the main patron. That's the key thing right there. And therefore, all celebrated art was Christian. Most people think of cathedrals, and they are places of worship. That's exactly what it is. And until we get to the modern era of art, thank you, Bella. Until we get to the modern era of art, a very good way to think about art when you're looking at art in context is to think about, I guess you could say, follow the money. I mean, who commissioned the work of art? You didn't have artists just making these things willy-nilly. They were commissioned by a pope to paint a ceiling. They were painted by a king to paint a portrait of the prince. They were commissioned by very wealthy people to do a family portrait that shows how wealthy they were. But there was always a context for the art. And up until the era of the modern art, until the modern art era, that's where art came from, very specific context. It was after that that everything, artists started doing what they wanted. And incidentally, without putting too much focus on it. That's when art kind of took off in about a million directions, culminating in the beginning of the 20th century. But I digress. Let's play this interesting video on ancient Greece and ancient Rome, please. 7 minutes long.
Arturo Pettore here, but you can call me Art. This is Explorations in Art History, starring me and the hand. Me, Lou. People watching from around the world, and I'm stuck waiting on some five-fingered prima donna. That's better. Woo! That Mediterranean wind feels pretty breezy. It looks like we'll be talking about the Greek and Roman period. Leave it to the Greeks to turn geometry into art. 1000 to 700 BC marked a period in Greek art called the geometric period, because of the decorations on the pottery of the day. Simple geometric designs were combined into a repeating pattern that circled the pot. Later, abstract figures of animals and people appeared. They used pots for storing wine and oil, for eating and drinking, as prizes at athletic games, and even as burial markers. Start as a tot, end as a pot.
It was a joke. Let me out.
In the Archaic period, their art began to move toward more realistic portrayals of the figure. From the Egyptians, Greeks learned the trick of adding hair down the back of their marble statues to give strength to the neck area, and spreading the stance of the legs to give a statue stability. Ow! Too much stability! Male statues were called kouros, and the females, kourae. Greek pottery styles changed as well. They created the popular black figure wear style, which showed black figures on red pots. And then they reversed the formula into another popular style called red figure wear, showing red figures against a black background. Red figure or black? Which one makes me look thinner? Greece, however, wasn't one big happy country at the time. Instead, they had several Greek city-states. The two top dogs, Athens and Sparta, were often at odds, jockeying for position and power, until the Persians attacked in 480 BC. Then Athens and Sparta dropped their differences for the moment, and together they repulsed the invaders. But not before Persia had done some serious damage to the city of Athens. It was time for the Athenians to rebuild. Surging with confidence after their triumph over the Persian Empire, the Greeks launched into a golden age called the Classical Period. Pericles, the leader of Athens, ordered the rebuilding of the temples on the Acropolis, where the famous sculptor Phidias decorated the Parthenon, a temple dedicated to Athena, the founding goddess of Athens. Classic sculptures became more realistic and at the same time, idealistic. Sculptors like Polykleitos searched for the mathematically perfect proportions of human beauty. Poses became more natural by using principles like contrapposto, a pose that gave an elegant balance to the figure by shifting the angles of the shoulders to the pelvis. Using the ratio of the size of the head to the body, Greek artists discovered that the average male or female has a proportional height of 6.5 to 7 heads. By increasing the size of the body to the head, they discovered a more visually appealing proportion. Even today, comic book artists use these idealized proportions to draw superheroes.
Art will smash! Yeah!
In 336 BC, Alexander the Great took power and spread the Greek Empire from Egypt to the borders of India. His death ended the Classical period. In the Hellenistic period, Greek sculptors still popped out amazingly lifelike sculptures, but now they added more emotion and action, like poor Laocoon and his two sons being strangled by two giant snakes sent by the gods as punishment. The sculptor Praxiteles broke the long Greek tradition of portraying male subjects in the nude and the females clothed with his Aphrodite of Cnidos, which became the first nude woman. More Roman copies were made of this Greek sculpture than any other. The idea of empire appealed to the Romans too, and in 214 BC, they took control of Greece. The Romans loved Greek culture. They copied Greek statues, paintings, and architecture. They even adopted the Greek gods, though they renamed them all. Zeus, meet Jupiter. Poseidon, meet Neptune. Aphrodite, meet Venus. The Romans, though, were much more interested in portraiture of real people. Instead of seeking the ideal, they sought for a true likeness of their subject.
Yeah, warts and all.
Also, Romans used art as propaganda to promote a political agenda and glorify emperors and their exploits. Emperor Augustus had himself portrayed as a strong young military leader in his warrior's breastplate, even though he was much older at the time. Kind of like some people's Facebook picture. Trajan's column is like movie scenario in stone, the sculpted scenes depicting Roman battles and their ultimate victory. Roman architects became masters of the arch and the dome. The arch was a huge innovation for the creation of bridges and aqueducts. And the dome became the staple of big official buildings, like the Pantheon, which became one of the most influential buildings in Western architecture. The expansion of the Roman Empire spread Greek and Roman ideas throughout Europe, which formed the foundation of Western culture. Even today, we are still influenced by ideas developed in ancient Greece and Rome.
There you go. That is, that is our little session on ancient Greek and Rome. If you're interested, there's a lot more that you can read about. You can read about the architecture. You can read about the painting, which actually is the images on those vessels to hold wine and to hold olive oil. Fascinating. And combine that with the poetry and the drama and the histories of those wars that he was talking about. You've got a very, very, very fascinating era. Now we're going to talk about Christianity and the formation of Europe. And again, time keeps fleeting, and we're not going to talk about why Rome fell, how that led into Christianity. There was no clean break. It wasn't one day Rome ended, Christianity began the next day. Y'all, there's the story, you know it or you don't know it, but the fact is art changed quite a bit in that period. And there's two time periods. We're talking about early Christian art, which is Byzantium, and it's very decorative, and actually it's quite lovely. And we're talking about art of the Middle Ages, and that's probably work that you might be more familiar with. And that, incidentally, is the kind of work of the cathedral that Philip went to, Philip from Orange went to when he was 8. There's not a lot of Christian art that is still around, again, with any of these cultures. What we find of early Christian art exists mostly from burial chambers. So that's why we have a lot of the, that's why we have a lot of architecture and not so much paintings and things like that. The Romans borrowed quite a bit from the subject matter from Greek and Roman art. And in point of fact, early Christian churches, before they started making those big cathedrals, were actually based on the floor plans of Roman basilicas. So we're going to look at, very briefly, some images here of the rise of Christianity. Can we see those, please? The first is Christ as the Son. It's the details of a mosaic. It's in St. Peter's. And it's Christ, all right, but you can see that it's meant to be Christ, but you can also see that it's kind of, he's being conflated with perhaps Apollo, the Greek god. So the transition from the Olympian deities to Christianity was not, as I said, clear cut. There was a lot of overlap. We have an image of the St. Paul's outside the wall in Rome. And again, that's what Philip was talking about. We're going to see even more elaborate examples later. Your eyes go up. Your eyes go up because of the columns, and your eyes go up because of the arches. And what do you see when you're looking up? Well, in this case, you're looking at some extremely elaborate sculptural images up there on the very top. We're looking at an image of Constantine the Great. It's a it's actually a marble head. Okay. Now, when we talked about, we're talking about Byzantine rulers, and they consider themselves to be the legitimate followers of the Roman emperors. So there was no, as far as they were concerned, there was no stoppage. You went from Roman emperor to the rulers of Byzantine, like Constantinople. So when you talk about the work, you're going to look at things that have, there's images that are becoming more and more realistic, but they also show the splendor of, just the simple splendor of art that is based on Christian subject matter. And like I said, I love art from Byzantium because it's very stylized, it's flattened, it's abstracted to a great extent. The subject matter, it's, again, this is for people that couldn't necessarily read, but they can understand religious doctrines and beliefs by looking at the images. And they're also famous for their very sumptuous icons, which are portraits or images of famous people or famous events. We have an image of a church in Ravenna called San Vitale. Just look at the mosaic. You're looking up, by the way. We have a detail of the mosaic. Empress. It shows the Empress Theodora and her retinue, which is her posse. We have an image of a mosaic depicting Christ as Pantocrator in Sicily. So you see, he's showing, these artists, these nameless artists, are showing Christ as a very omnipotent person, but they're also showing him as representing some kind of beauty. There's something very magnificent about this. And again, if you consider the context of this, it's being made for a church, and they're trying to show God in his glory. Everything is meant to do that. So you're going to have a lot of gold, a lot of things that look like gold. Your eyes are going to go upward. The scale is going to be huge. And it's meant to instill in you what could be called an awe-inspiring sense of Christianity. Then let's move on. Actually, you know what we can do? A better way to do this with the cathedrals and stuff. We're going to look at we have a 5-minute video, which will take us to right before the end of the class. Let's look at the video of the Middle Ages, because it'll go through this stuff much faster, and it'll give you a context for the rest of the material, and then we'll cut back with about 2 minutes to go in the class. Thank you.
Oh, hi, Arturo Pittore here, but you can call me Art. This is Explorations in Art History, starring me. And the hand. What about the rest of me? How embarrassing. Man, people watching from around the world. I'm stuck waiting on some five-fingered prima donna. Oh. Well, that's better, right? See? It looks like we'll be talking about the medieval and Byzantine periods. It had taken many lifetimes and countless battles to conquer and maintain the vast regions of the Roman Empire. When Emperor Theodosius I took power, he ruled over lands that stretched from Portugal to Palestine. The question of succession of power had always been a thorny problem in the empire, and for Theodosius, it came down to a choice between two sons. Or did it? In 395 AD, Theodosius instead split the empire in half. The western half became the domain of his son, Honorius. We call it the Western Roman Empire. The eastern half was awarded to his son, Arcadius, and became known as the Byzantine Empire. The two kingdoms both considered themselves Roman, though they spoke Latin in the west and Greek in the east. Honorius and the Western Roman Empire were besieged by barbarian hordes from the beginning. Huns, Goths, Vandals, and Franks all took turns invading Western territories. Sacking Rome became a barbarian pastime, and the Vandals, thanks to their exceptional knack for destruction and violence, gave us the word vandalism.
Ow! I hate when that happens!
It was a rough and tumble time. Only 81 years after the death of Theodosius, the Western Roman Empire ceased to exist. With the empire splintered into separate countries, the one unifying force to remain was the Catholic Church and the Pope. The Byzantine Empire, on the other hand, would last another 1,000 years. In 730 AD, Emperor Leo III initiated a movement called iconoclasm, based on a strict interpretation of the Ten Commandments, which forbade the making and worshiping of graven images, and, perhaps due to the rising influence of Islamic culture, the iconoclasts sought the removal or destruction of paintings and sculptures.
There's one!
This way, man! Look at it! Get it!
Gutted that one!
There's one.
There's another one! Go and get it!
Ah! We're too late!
There's one.
There's another one!
No, stop him!
Stop him now! Hurry! Caught him in the act! Take the scoundrel away!
Well, anyway, you get a sense of the fact that the art comes out of a very specific historical culture. And I want to conclude by saying this goes back to the very first question of the day that I posed to you guys. God, it seems forever ago. And that was, can you understand a work of art by looking at it, or do you have to know something about it? And, you know, my contention is, at first glance, you just have to look at it, and that's why we do the let's take a walks and study the vocabulary. But if you want to learn a lot more about the mosaics in Ravenna, for instance, or the Greek choros, the boy statues and stuff, you can read about them very easily. You can look it up in Wikipedia. There's Encyclopedia Britannica, and it'll give you a fascinating story of the context from which all this stuff came from. So we've begun our march into art history, and we've covered the ancient Mediterranean worlds. We've gone through ancient Greece and ancient Rome, and we've covered the Middle Ages. And this was just to jumpstart everything. Now we're going to kind of settle down and do a lot less and focus more on what I think are going to be fascinating eras. The first one we're going to do is going to be the Renaissance. And we are going to do that next week. And I'm going to continue to have these videos. I think the videos are informative. I think they're fun. I think they're a good break, so I'm just not talking all the time. And for the rest of the term, there'll be one per class. Again, we covered quite a bit of material this time, and I just wanted to break them up with the videos. Anyway, you'll get credit for all these wonderful responses, even if I don't get to them. So in the meantime, good luck on ArtSight paper and everything, and take care. Thank you. Bye.